30 minutes, and if there are any questions afterwards, I would appreciate it. I've divided this talk into four areas. I'd like to talk about four fundamental issues. First, I'll start by getting a description of what graphic design will do. In the second part, I'll look at different types of research. Thirdly, I can combine these first two parts and indicate how graphic design and research are related. And in the end, I'll tell you if you get each other, live happily ever after. About 5 years ago, I started to investigate professional practice. My university is based in Great Island, Netherlands, which is a fairly small city in the south. I went into the city and tried to get to come into contact with graphic designers, people who work as graphic designers in this particular city. Initially, I just made a small list of companies based on websites, on phone directories, on the yellow pages, and so on. And very quickly, we found that there were about 100 graphic design agencies. You can travel from here to here in about 15 minutes. This is the medieval centre, and the map clearly shows that it is not necessary for graphic designers to work at the city centre. Most of them work outside. We have continued searching, and we've got now a list of 107 graphic design agencies in Breda. The average is 3 designers per agency. We found another 200 graphic designers working for advertising companies, printers, communication advice bureaus, and larger companies. So at the moment, I've got a phone number of 700 graphic designers working in a city of 140,000 people. That means that 1 in 200 people, children, adults, and pensioners, is making his money or her money as a graphic designer. That is more than we ever anticipated. But so what? Are these companies really doing proper design work as we would understand it? Or are they just young university dropouts with stolen Macintosh and some illegal software? So what we did was that we went into town and interviewed these people. We interviewed graphic design companies about their work. We interviewed information designers. We interviewed advertising agencies and web designers. At the moment, we've got, on say, about 150 interviews. And basically, we ask them 4 questions. What are you doing? Why are you doing it? Who are you doing it for? And how do you know that your work is any good? And what seems to be the case? Is there anything that they have these 150 very different design companies have in common? And fortunately, I can say yes. They have 2 patterns in common, and I'll show you these 2 patterns. The first pattern, there's 2 patterns in common. The first pattern is that graphic designers develop the shape of information. That's not something new to you, that's what you do every day. They consider the visual configuration of information. The second pattern is related to the decisions that they make to make the visual configuration possible. Actual designing is only part of what graphic designers do. There are a number of other things that graphic designers need to do to design. First, I'll show you some more details about these 2 patterns and after that I'll apply them to research. I'm sorry, all visual designers that we've interviewed work with visual elements. Designers tell us that they work with text, with images, with schematic elements, and with separable combinations. And for this audience, it's not necessary, it might even be an insult to explain to you what visual elements are. But I give presentations to pharmacists and to medical regulators and lawyers, and these people don't have an idea that there are different typefaces in this world, and that you can modify photograph. And that's why I show this picture of the elements on the left hand side, on a simple box of a light bulb. The colored dots simply show where there's visual elements appear on a page. On a box, and you can use this structure of 4 elements for different types of elements for needing all graphic design. All graphic designers and interviewers recognize these types and indicate that they consider them on a daily basis. And some designers edit that these visual elements can be animated as well, can be accompanied by sound. And we've seen some good examples yesterday, Andreas Stucker and Yussi and Labour?
Yes.
But considering the official elements only, can go on forever and ever and ever. In this example, the colours of the box could be changed, the photograph could be changed, the logo could be put in different areas, the dimensions of each of the elements could be modified. But what is the purpose of these changes? Why would category change it? Why would the designer choose this particular configuration? And that leads to the second group of activities of graphic designers. The second group of activity of designers is to consider the visual aims. Why would anybody choose particular elements? There are three strategies to achieve those aims. Graphic designers always try to make a combination of visual identity, that is, who is the information coming from, where is the information, who is saying anything. There's the visual representation, that's about the contents, and there's the visual orientation, that's to help the people through it. Basically, you have to tell a story to help people through information. That's the visual orientation. And all of these terms of interviews use different words to describe these three strategies. But all of them recognize these three strategies when we ask them afterwards. But considering the visual strategy only, does still not cover all the activities graphic designers do. When they sit behind their very large computer screens at the moment, graphic designers can think that these visual aims have been achieved, that it is clear that the content has been represented clearly, that the identity is clear, that the story has been told properly. But graphic designers are not the ones to decide. Third activity actually does that. They have to take into account the commissioner and the beholders. And I still have not found a word in the English language that really encompasses the people who read and interpret visual information. I've tried to use this as a word, but that seems to have connotation with drug abuse. Alternatives like people, readers, viewers, citizens, audience are all too wide and not appropriate. So I stick with the clumsy word beholder, but you know what I mean. It's the reader. Graphic designers always work for commissioners. The role of a designer is to clarify the relation between the commissioner and the beholder. In this example, it's clear that Philips tries to sell a particular light bulb by attracting the attention of people who might be interested in this light bulb. Designers anticipate what beholders want to know and anticipate what commissioners want to say. Visual design shows this dialogue. Visual design makes the relation between the commissioner and the beholder clear. So now we have all the activities that graphic designers do. This sort of complete diagram looks like. This is not my view, this is what the graphic designers told me. Visual designers consider these three at the same time. They consider the elements, the strategy, and the dialogue. But if all is well, then this is not new to you at all. You recognize this is your daily work. This is what graphic designers do all the time. And this is what we sell our commissioners. Graphic designers are able to consider visual dialogues, visual strategies, visual elements together. It's that simple. However, when you start talking to graphic designers, this is only part of their job. This is the most interesting part. This is what you're fascinated about. And this is what this conference we've seen many examples of. But until you start asking further questions, graphic design usually stops here. But this is only part of the story. The second part is a pattern that seems to be applicable to most designers. And that starts again from a small start. This is the circle we saw earlier. So I reduce the size of the circle to the top part and I continue with a second activity. And the second activity is the organization project. Visual designers plan and manage projects. They balance the necessary time, skills, and knowledge, and the associated costs. This is not a one-off activity. This is done before every project, during every project, and at the end of every project to write the invoice. And if you manage several projects at the same time, then this is very complex. One project is okay, five projects are difficult, 50 projects, you need a project management. That's a specific skill in graphic design. The third activity is that graphic designers must do is persuade commissioners that their design has certain benefits. arguments that a designer develops through the design need to be presented in writing and in person. These arguments need to be structured to ensure that people can understand why design looks like it does. But even the most convincing presentation cannot provide all the arguments. Most of the graphic designers do some form of testing. They have to test and evaluate. This can be from a very formal testing, like asking a colleague what they think of it, to a very formal usability test with very carefully designed code. Testing and evaluation is a fourth activity that's constantly done by all designers in all projects. Fifth activity is modification after the design has been approved. So you've shown to the commissioner, it has been approved, you've shown to your colleagues, you have user tested it, and now you've got it into production. You have to modify the design to make it possible to produce it. It suddenly turns out that the Chinese printer you have in mind cannot deal with it, so you have to go somewhere else. You have to modify your design to do that. They're all necessary to bring graphic design into production. Where am I? Now it gets more complicated. The sixth consideration all graphic designers have to take is the most problematic one. Graphic designers need to consider the situation in which they work. This has to do with factors like social, financial, historical, and linguistic issues. I cannot work in Poland because I don't speak Polish. It's that simple. An example of the situation is the healthcare system in Poland, or the election system in the Netherlands, or public transport in Venice. But before you can do anything, you need to have a feeling for these situations. You need to speak the language, you to recognize the status of people, you need to know a bit about the history, and you need to know about the standard ways of working in a particular context. And the seventh issue is that you have to have a specific problem within a situation. You can't change the whole situation, you have to deal with it. But within that situation, you have to narrow the project down to a particular problem. Designers look at a particular problem situation. They select the boundaries of the problems, usually in the discretion of the commissioner. So a problem could be considered